Thank you for joining us today for this webinar on reclaiming narratives. My name is Sukyun Lee, and I am faculty and English language learning specialist in graduate liberal arts at the Maryland Institute College of Art, otherwise known as MICA. I will be moderating today's panel discussion and invite all of you to participate in this important conversation. I hope the theme speaks for itself, but I am inspired by the many, many conversations I have shared with MICans about being seen, heard, valued, and respected, no matter what our narratives may be. So just a few logistics. For MICA students, please use the QR code to check into the event. Live questions from the audience can be submitted through the Q&A feature. We will do our best to include as many questions as possible. This webinar is being recorded and will be available for view. Also, I would like to thank Graduate Studies at MICA for sponsoring this event and the Office of Events for providing technical support. Today, we are joined by brilliant women from across three continents. Darrée is the Assistant Curator of Indigenous Art of the Americas at the Baltimore Museum of Art, and she also teaches at MICA in the graphic design department. Seun has her PhD in intercultural and international leadership in higher education. She joins us from Duke, where she is the Assistant Vice Provost of Undergraduate Education. Christine joins us from the Netherlands. She holds a master's in cultural analysis from the University of Amsterdam and is the creator and founder of StoryCraft. Ray is a MICA alum from the MFA in filmmaking program. She is a visual media producer and an excellent educator. Each panelist will also introduce themselves more before we dive into our discussion. To share the context, to set up the context, two creatives influenced the theme of this event. Vietnamese independent filmmaker, feminist, and post-colonial theorist Trinh Thi Minh Hà coined the term speaking nearby. Minh Hà's documentary, Reassemblage, begins with her voice stating, "I do not intend to speak about, just speak nearby." Her film conveys a visceral critique of traditional ethnographic methods and ways of seeing the other. Another muse is Teresa Hakyung Cha's Dictée. It's a haunting autobiographical manifesto that powerfully reclaims her own narrative within the blurred spaces of liminality. We hope for this time and space to be challenging, thought-provoking, but also meaningfully encouraging by resonating a shared joy in reclaiming our narratives. Now, I would like to welcome Darrée to kick us off with the introductions.
Hi there, I'm so happy to be here today with these wonderful women. I'm gonna start off before introducing myself, I'm gonna give a land acknowledgement. So I live near the MICA campus and I know many of you are in that region, so I'll focus on that. The MICA campus is located on the ancestral and unceded lands of the Piscataway and Susquehannock tribes. We recognize the lasting presence of Indigenous peoples in this region and acknowledge the broken promises and treaties, as well as the history of oppression that those people have experienced and continue to experience to this day. Though a statement cannot adequately address the history of dispossession, it is a step that we can take to honor and acknowledge the way that Indigenous people have stewarded the land for generations. So as Sukyun said, I am Darrée Turner. I am a member of the Yurok Tribe of California and also the Assistant Curator of Indigenous Art of the Americas, as well as a faculty member in the graphic design team. At MICA, I teach classes including design theory and practice, senior seminar and flexible design studio, and lecture on topics ranging from colonized and decolonial design to manifestos. And at the Baltimore Museum of Art, I curate Native art, and have recently unveiled a show called Stripes and Stars, Reclaiming Lakota Independence, that analyzes the way that Lakota women in the late 19th century used images of the American flag in their beadwork to communicate subversive and protective messages. So that exhibition is open until March, and hopefully you have a chance to see it. Thank you again, and I'll give it away.
Hi, everyone. It's wonderful to be with you this afternoon. My name is Șeun Bello Olámosù. And like Sukyun said, I work at Duke University. I've been at Duke for 14 years. And before the current position I'm in, I actually worked quite a bit on the internationalization efforts, particularly around intercultural education for the institution, supporting staff, faculty, students, and academic departments and the medical center staff on what it means to have an interculturally diverse landscape. And my path to intercultural education, I think, stemmed from my own personal experiences. I grew up in Nigeria, West Africa, and came to the US at college age. And I came to the US, lived in Greenville, North Carolina, which is Eastern North Carolina. And I was exposed to certain population within that town that, probably was encountering somebody from another country for the first time. They didn't know where Nigeria was, couldn't understand my accent when I first moved in the mid 90s. And I couldn't understand people's accent either, even though, English was my first language, one of my first languages. I've always been multilingual. And so it was fascinating to me to be in a space where there was this much, confusion about being able to communicate, even though we were speaking the same language. There were all manner of, conceptions that were held about me or what I brought to the table that was foreign and challenging. And so when I found the opportunity to create space to share my story and for other people to share their story, it was like finding my life's calling. And that's put me on a journey to validating what everybody brings to the table, the importance of what we all share and what we can all learn from each other. And I continue to do that in different spaces at Duke and beyond. And it's wonderful to be with this wonderful set of women, and I'm excited about this session today.
Hi, my name is Christine Taylor, and I'm coming to you from Nijmegen in the Netherlands. I am Taiwanese American, and I grew up in the United States, Germany, Saudi Arabia, and Switzerland. And I've been in the Netherlands now since 2004. And these days I hold two passports, Dutch and American. And a lot of my journey has been about deciding whether I was going to tell these stories or not tell those stories. And I didn't for a long time until just a few years ago, I started sharing who I was. And that was an important part for me of reclaiming my story by simply telling it. For the last 4 years, I've been combining intercultural work with storytelling through StoryCraft here in the Netherlands. And I'm very, very excited to be a part of this conversation with these very interesting women from all over the place. And I can't wait to see what happens this evening.
Hi, everyone. My name is Ray, and I'm an American-born Korean storyteller and educator currently based in South Korea. It is 4 a.m. and I'm currently developing a dramedy I'd like to one day pitch to Netflix. Some of the questions I'm currently working with are about the concept of home, self-worth, and the liminal spaces between cultural identities. I'm really looking forward to having this much needed conversation with all of you amazing women. Thank you so much, Sukyun and MICA, for giving us this opportunity.
Excellent. Thank you. So we will delve into three themes for this discussion. The first theme will address the question, what is the me in society? The second question we will focus on, how does one hold on to and maintain narratives in everyday life? And we will wrap things up by addressing how do you guard your narrative when it is stolen from you? So we have a lot to talk about. Without further ado, let's dive right in. So the first question, I would like to invite Seun and Dare to respond first and then have some follow-up discussion. How can we share our narrative with the community and reclaim it?
Yes, that's an excellent question. You know, I love how Madiba, Nelson Mandela puts it. He says, if you want the cooperation of humans and you must make them feel they are important. And you do that by being genuine and humble. And so two things come to mind here about sharing our narratives with the community and reclaiming it. One is the importance of being self-aware, right? We need to understand who we are and, you know, the worldview that we have and what has conditioned us over the years, the experiences, the upbringing that we have. We should value what we add to the world around us and the tensions around what we value, right? And this is a lot of work because it's going to require us to be reflective and at times to ask questions of ourselves that we just don't spend time asking those around us questions, reading more, opening ourselves up to uncomfortable, you know, conversations. And the second thing, you know, that I think it's important for sharing our narrative and with the community and reclaiming it is also being authentic, right? It requires a lot of knowledge of who we are, you know, how we are shaped, how we've been shaped, how we see the world, how the world sees us, and understanding the value of what we bring to the table and being willing to contribute, right? Being willing to show up in our true self. I think one of the areas there for me has been my name, and I'm going to keep referring to that over and over again, throughout this conversation, is coming to the US, the name is not difficult, but it's different, right? And acknowledging that it's different to the ears of others, and me also in some ways taking a stance of being willing to be patient and to, you know, teach and support this difference and how people have to embrace it. And so one last thought that I would like to leave with you is really the issue of melting pot versus the salad bowl in thinking of cultures. A lot of times people will proudly refer to the US as a beautiful melting pot. The problem with the melting pot is that everything loses its identity, right? And its authenticity. I like to think of also the heat that makes everything melt, you know, the discomfort of that, of making everybody blend versus the salad bowl where, you know, you have the spinach, you have the greens, you have the tomatoes, you have the raisins, whatever you like in your salad, cucumbers, whatever you like in it. But then you have the dressing that tries to create some kind of taste and can differentiate it. And that could be the space and the culture and some commonalities, but that everybody is still able to be distinct, but still be something and doing something together. So, you know, thinking of that metaphor in some ways is concrete ways that we can hold on while we share who we are with others. Thank you.
Thank you for that powerful example. Yes, Dare.
You know, that brings up the example you offered of names, you know, feels really relevant for me. So my full name is Darian, and my parents gave me the nickname Dare very intentionally. So nicknames and Native culture are really important. And there was a lot of my professional life, I went by Darian, and people didn't even know that I went by Dare with my friends. And as I transitioned to moving to Baltimore and working at MICA and working at the BMA, I really took ownership of Dare. And that's who I am in my heart. And so I feel like that's something that really resonates, that the idea of naming. So when I'm thinking about sharing a narrative with a community in the Native context and how we can reclaim our narratives, there are several different communities that we need to think about. One is your specific tribe, if you're a Native person. Then another is all Native peoples. And then yet another is inclusive of everybody, including like white audience members or people of different backgrounds who are non-Native. And the different stories you tell to those audiences will sort of transform based on the nature of the story and who you're sharing that story with. So there are certain stories that should really just belong to tribal members and maybe just specific people in that tribe who hold that story and choose to share it with people selectively. And it's important to respect that. Not every story belongs to every audience. And I think that also thinking about my role as a museum curator, we have to constantly navigate how the stories of Native people are shared with the community overall, and whose voices do we prioritize in those storytelling methods. So you want to create a space where Native people feel respected and that they are co-equal authorities and creators of the stories that are represented in the galleries. So we're taking it out of this colonial context, which museums come from. They are the, you know, the colonizers' tools. We have to strip that away and really reclaim the stories of Native peoples in this case by highlighting the ways that cultures have survived and gone beyond just mere survival and embrace this concept, this Native concept called survivance. And specifically that means a rejection of victimhood and a rejection of narratives of dominance, of Native peoples being dominated by other outside cultures, and showing that there's a vitality and a real living culture present with Native peoples all over the world and all over the United States. So that to me is the way that my community can really reclaim our stories. So thank you.
Oh, please continue, Christine.
Oh, I didn't say anything yet. Oh gosh, it's so exciting to listen to different viewpoints. I'm really, actually the word survivance is one I've never heard before, and it's hit me right in the heart because what I am more than anything is an international. So someone who's constantly living somewhere that isn't where I'm from. And these days, even when I'm in the States, because I've been away for so long, I don't feel like I'm from there. And I have people tell me I'm not from there. It's that kind of an experience. And a lot of internationals, people who choose to move abroad or are in a situation where they have to live abroad, really take on this victimhood thing. They have to bear the burden of living in the Netherlands. They have to bear the burdens of not having things that are familiar to them, or having to deal with a different culture, or having to deal with a different idea of what's right and wrong, and a different value system. And this idea of survivance is so beautiful, because essentially it suggests that if you get to decide what your story is, not someone else, and that your story is the story that you tell. And I think that's something that we ignore, which is that if you want to reclaim your narrative, you have to start telling your story. You can't just think you represent it or feel like you're living it. You have to be willing to share what you've been through, if that's pain, if that's triumph, if that's struggle, all of those things, when you share them, that sometimes is the first act of reclaiming. And I think a lot of us, if we look back into our lives, we'll find that there's probably more story you're not telling than you are telling. And the question is, if you go back, how do you figure out which are the parts that you want to tell, that you want to claim as your own? Because a story is like the whole of your life. You get to pick the parts you want to tell. That's why storytelling is so powerful. So you can create that however you want it, whatever you want it to be. And so this concept of survivance somehow for me has to do with this process of deciding what story you want to tell about yourself today, because tomorrow might be different and next year might be another version as well. So I think, yeah, very exciting.
Thank you for sharing. Absolutely. What I was saying before was just the statement that not every story belongs to every person was very powerful and resonated with me, because I haven't had that thought, you know, spoken that way before. And also the name example, what a powerful example. Your name means so much. It really is a core to your identity. And when it is, differently pronounced or perhaps not quite fitting into traditional, a traditional framework, how do we navigate that and take ownership of that as well? Ray.
I wanted to add to that. I don't know, Sukyun, if you remember, but when I first met you at a coffee shop, we were ordering our drinks. And so we paid and we were waiting. And the order was ready. And all of a sudden I hear Susan, and Sukyun and I like exchanged looks, and I was like, oh no, I totally understand why you told that person your name was Susan, because it's so much easier. Because, you know, they're gonna get the spelling incorrectly, or it's gonna hold up the line, or all these other ideas of, and you know, all of that goes in when you're ordering a cup of coffee. So I can only imagine, right? Like how that slows down your process throughout your daily life. It's really hard.
And I mean, that story, anyway. So I wanna add a little bit onto that. You know, I arrived in the United States at the age of 8, and the doctor who gave me my immunization shots said, your name is too hard. Why don't you just go by Susan? And so from the age of 8 until the year 2011, I always introduced myself as Susan in the United States. And I think that just speaks to the exhaustion, right? I mean, it took me till 2011 to have the courage to put my foot down and say, my name is not Susan, my name is Sukyun. And so, of course, you know, legally it was never Susan, but it was just the way that I introduced, like at work, my coworkers, they all called me Susan. My students called me Susan. So it sounds strange to me now saying it, but I guess I just want to encourage others, you know, or make that statement that it may be such a simple thing, but speaking your story takes courage. It takes courage. And, you know, we are not alone. We are not alone. So, excellent. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. And this one I'm going to direct to Ray and Christine first. What does it mean to be the hero of your own journey?
I was thinking about this, and I kind of wanted to say something along these lines when Christine was talking about telling your story, and the idea of victimhood. And so I was gonna say, like, even though I was born, raised, and a resident of California for 22 years, being a woman and Asian and the child of a single immigrant mother, I was conditioned from a very early age to recognize that America was not my home. There's this concept in Korean called nunchi, which according to Wikipedia, means the subtle art and ability to listen and gauge others' moods. And to visualize that a little bit, when I was younger, my mom was really busy, like working multiple jobs. So I was bounced around from one family member to another. And even though it wasn't my family's intention to make me feel uncomfortable in any kind of way, you know, I had to nunchiba, which, you know, means like I needed to use nunchi in order to make sure that I was respecting each family member's like schedules, boundaries, preferences. But like this, I feel like I always nunchiba when I'm in the States, because, you know, there isn't a shortage of evidence that I'm a minority. You know, that it's a privilege for me to have grown up in the States. So it wasn't until actually I mailed in my absentee ballot several weeks ago where I realized that voting for me was my way of asking for official permission to belong, you know, to make America my home. So I think the trick to being the hero of our own journeys is to believe and operate in our daily lives as if we're home.
Excellent, thank you. Christine, oh yeah.
I feel like I have to pause for that. It's such a contrast with the way I look at this, because I look at this question of how do you, are you the hero in your own story from a purely story structure perspective, which is that the hero is an archetypal figure in a story. And I work with a lot of people who are hesitant to be the hero in their own story because they think it's a function of ego to make themselves the hero of the story. Because, you know, the hero is Luke Skywalker, Harry Potter, however you want to see it. Of course, I name only men, sorry. But the person who's the center of attention. And when it comes to story structure, the hero is not the center of attention. They're the perspective of the story. That's the person's story that you're telling. Meaning that if you're telling your story, the only person you can be in that story is the hero. Because your perspective is the perspective that is the one that matters for the story. If you're telling someone else's story, then they're going to be the hero. You're going to tell their story. But the things that help people to understand and be comfortable with this, with being the hero in your own story, is that heroes are flawed. There is no perfect hero. Heroes are interesting because they're flawed. And that a story is always about the transformation of the hero. So you may gain knowledge, you may change your life situation, but your story is about how you grow and learn and overcome obstacles, internal and external. That's what makes a hero heroic. Heroes aren't heroic at the beginning of their story. They have to earn that. And I think that when you start to think about your own story as a history of all of these things, whether it's nunchiba or writing someone else's name on your coffee cup or giving someone else's name for your coffee cup, those are all things we overcome and they form us and they make us, you know, Sukyun, they make us a storyteller with film or whatever we do. And if we can start to also claim those things that are painful as the things that grow us and the things that give us our strength, that changes the story that we can tell. So I actually think that what it means to be the hero of your own journey is to understand that you are not the person now that you were at the beginning, and you are not the person now that you are going to become in the future. With it's all, we're in transition, and this is just a moment. So that's kind of where my thoughts go. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you both. I do want to remind the audience that the Q&A feature is open. So if you have any questions, please do feel free to submit them. We are happy to, you know, have that interaction with y'all because it is a webinar setting, I guess. So thank you for sharing, everybody. Christine, did you have more to add or?
Nope.
Okay, Ray.
I wanted to add something. Christine, I really wanted to thank you for making that distinction between perspective and ego. I think that's something that I'm working on right now. Like, I keep thinking that telling my story is taking up attention, but you know, having spent a lot of time minimizing myself, I'm realizing, oh, you know, like, it's just such a habit. So I'm like trying to tell myself, like, I just need to tell my stories and it doesn't matter what I say, just as long as I have the courage to keep on streaming it, you know? So thank you for making that distinction. I think I'm gonna think about that for a really long time.
I have one more thing now.
Oh, please.
for you, because you gave us Nunchiba. There is a word in Dutch, and it's you say bestaansrecht, and it's the right to exist. And I think that when we're not telling our stories, we are giving up our right to exist. And the bestaansrecht is I have the right to be here in this room, to take up space, to have needs, to have emotions, and to share them. And it's a concept that's helped me a lot with trying to figure out how to navigate being the invisible immigrant or the person who's always having to shy back or blend or pay attention to everything else. No. Actually, I'm in the room too. And like Seun said, I'm bringing something.
Can you teach us how to say that word?
Bestaansrecht. I'll put it in the chat for everybody.
Yes.
Christine, something you said really, or just your perspective on this idea of what it means to be our hero really resonates with me. I was, I'm embarrassed to say this, but I was happy that this question was not assigned to me as the primary respondent, because I don't feel very comfortable embracing this idea of being the hero and taking up space and demanding attention. So that your perspective is really helpful for me. I will say that in terms of being a hero, I think about that as fulfilling not external expectations of what I should be, but internal. So not letting society determine who I should be, what I should say, what stories I should care about, but instead embracing whatever it is I feel is important to me. And not being static. So like you were saying, Christine, with this idea of the journey, I'm in the midst of it right now. I'm in my own hero's journey. I don't know where in the cycle I necessarily am, but I'm not static. I'm constantly changing and evolving and gaining new insights and perspectives. Seun, do you have any thoughts you want to share?
Yeah, I think of it, you know, the word hero also jumps out at me. And I think of it as really the relational piece of reclaiming our narratives. You know, I think the community is always very, very important to me. You know, why we are doing this work, why we need to hear the stories of one another is really about community. And so the hero to me actually, you know, is not in the spotlight. It's actually somebody who in some ways is thinking more of how the community can be stronger, right? Because we are only as strong as the weakest link. And a lot of times, even in these seasons, with the challenge of polarization and division we have in the nation is because we have one side trying to be the hero and the other side trying to be the hero, right? In the way that we think of it, like the loudest is the hero. But a lot of times is the ability to bring together, right? That really empowers. And that's how I think of the contribution of the hero in your journey is your ability to bring together, your ability to strengthen a community that you are in, the ability to to let, you know, that salad bowl know that, you know, if you, the tomato, are not there, it's not a Greek salad. You understand what I'm saying? That's just, that's the quickest example that comes to mind, that you can't be put away, right? But at the same time, you are contributing to the wholeness of that community. So, yeah. That's what I wanted to add, buttressing what everybody has said.
Thank you all so much to digest just in the short time that we've been talking. I do want to just put a note, and then we also have a question from the audience, but you know, we have been speaking so far in, you know, tribal or ethnic or immigration type settings, context, I should say. But I do, you know, I do think a part of it is also, you know, gender, right? Sexuality or whatever it may be in terms of your narrative and story that is unseen, not spoken for, unaccepted. And, you know, so my interest in intercultural communication really comes from trying to understand how to navigate that space, because we first have to have courage to be the sender and to communicate our message, but we also need to understand the receiver, right? And I think to speak to Sheyun's point, you know, how is community built through sharing our stories about our journeys, our narratives, and, you know, sharing a sense of belonging. How do we create that? What is that space like? And I think that's kind of what I am super interested in personally. So I just wanna bring that up. So the question from the audience is, what is survivance?
So survivance, we're taking the word survival and taking off the end there, AL, because there's a sense of finality to that. Once you've survived, that's it, you know, you're good. And that it expresses this idea of finiteness that survivance is trying to overturn. So it's unclear exactly, the scholar that put it forward was Gerald Visenor, and he never explains, I'm combining these two words. But if I were to guess what words he was combining, I would say survival with either perseverance or endurance, with this idea of moving forward in time. And it's something that is active rather than something that has happened in the past. So thank you. I hope that answers your question, but if you feel like you have extra questions that you'd like to ask, pop them in the Q&A.
Christine, go ahead.
Yeah, I was gonna say, Dara, just listening to you, I wonder if the extra word could be resilience, because if you,
there's so many good words that end in ants. It could be any of them, I think. I think there's a lot of different options. So thank you, Christine.
I love that. Great. So this is a great segue for us to jump into our second theme. And the second theme is basically about holding and maintaining our narratives. The question is, when your narrative is kind of hijacked per se or taken away, maybe intentionally, maybe not intentionally, what can you do to hold on to your narrative? And I am going to throw this to Christine first, and then anybody else who would like to join in.
I think that this is one of those really frightening things that happens to us when you watch someone tell you what your story is. And 9 times out of 10, they hit it so wrong. And then they change the subject. You don't get to say anything. And it's an incredibly painful experience. But I think also that happens when we haven't decided for ourselves what our narrative is. Let me put it this way. If someone looks at me and says, you're blonde, I say, no, I've got brown hair. You've got that wrong. Because it's an automatic response. I'm not gonna let them get away with telling me I'm something I'm not. And I think it's easier for people to hijack our narratives when we haven't figured out what we're trying to do, say, be, all of those things. So I think, not to be saying the same thing over and over, except it is the same thing over and over, is that the one thing you can do to reclaim your narrative is to have done the work of crafting your story, of knowing who you are and how you want to put yourself in the world, so that when someone tries to derail that, you can pull it right back, and that that pulling back isn't the effort of someone coming screaming out of the corner after not being heard for a long time. Because I know I've had that experience, particularly living in a foreign country, being in meetings in foreign languages, and I sit there and I want to say something for the duration of a meeting, the duration of a week, a month, a project, a relationship. And when I finally get to say it, if I haven't done the work of crafting it, I come out like a screaming banshee because all the emotion is on top. And that scares people away. But when I have started crafting my story and understanding this is who I want to be in this situation with these people, this is what I want to tell them about me, then I find they're far less likely to hijack my story because they don't have a chance. There's nothing to take, it's mine. It belongs to me. And I think the other part of what I just said is that storytelling, telling your story, can be incredibly strategic. Dare referenced it earlier that you have stories you tell in some, in certain circles, but I think it goes even a step further. There are the story you tell is for a purpose. There is a way you want to be seen. There is a thing you are trying to accomplish. You have all the material of your life to craft into a story, and you can take that and tell the story you need to tell to get something done. So your story is at your service, if you will. You are not the victim of your story. All the same things are coming back, but you get to make your story do what you need it to do. And I think that the other thing is that when people are hijacking your story, often they're trying to fill in something for themselves because they don't understand you. And that's because you've been withholding. I've had situations, you know, I know there was a time I got into a cab in Montreal. It was a very nice cab driver. He's like, so are you also from Peru? And he's, no, I'm not from Peru. I had another situation where I found out several months after meeting someone that they thought I was extremely rude when they first met me because they had greeted me in Spanish and I didn't respond. It was definitely related to the fact that I didn't speak any Spanish at the time. I've offended people for not speaking Malaysian. These people are not trying to take anything from me. They're actually trying to reach out. And if I give them a little bit of grace, then I can understand their mistakes a little much better. And those are like complimentary mistakes, right? Those are the things that happen to us that we can laugh about because they're kind of cute when they happen and they don't cause any pain. But one, I think the time that I realized that having my own story figured out was extremely important wasn't an identity moment, because that's harder for me to deal with. But in 2013, my husband got cancer. He's perfectly fine now. Don't worry about him. And when he got sick, we told people, and every person we told had their own version of what our pain was going to be. Every person had their own reaction to what was going on. And then we had people who would come and visit, and they would bring their own stories about what our crisis meant in our lives. And we very, very quickly established our own, like, the family narrative on this is. And when people came and said something else, we say, no, this is how we see it. And it helped a lot to cut off conversations that were painful, to also let the world know how we were going to deal with the situation. And that was the first time in my life, and I was unfortunately not very young at the time, it was the first time that I realized that if I had my story ready, no one could take it away from me, because I was just correcting them. I wasn't taking anything anymore. So I think doing the work on your story, doing the reflection work that Seun was talking about, is really key to making sure your story is yours. No one can take it from you because you own it. So I'm really curious to hear what other folks would have to say.
I mean, I would just like to add, and then we have another question from the audience, which is, I think, pretty similar to the next question that we had lined up anyway. But when you speak of reflection, and I think it's such a lost art. I don't know. And it is one of the hardest things to do in a sense, right? I mean, in one of my classes, I have students write a racial autobiography, And it's an assignment that they really struggle with because it takes that reflection and it takes defining what those words mean to you, what it means in society and how you're navigating that. And also for social change, it's just, you know, how do you push that forward? But did anyone else want to respond or add on to Christine before I address?
Yeah, I just wanted to share very quickly about what you said. I think one of the concrete ways I've practiced reflection, apart from I'm naturally introverted and I enjoy, you know, alone time and thinking through things, is something I learned a lot many, many years ago at the work retreat. It's called SBI, and it's situation, behavior, and the impact that it had on you. So what was the situation? What was the behavior? And what impact did it have on you? You know, and I think if we put ourselves in situations where, we put ourselves in a space where we are conscious. A lot of times we go through life being totally unconscious about how we behave in certain situations or how other people behave towards us. And so it's really being present, right, in what we say. Why are we saying it? Are we saying it because we are angry, or are we saying it to give the other party a pass? What is causing the emotions? What awakens what we do? I think in a lot of ways, that's part of how we claim the power. We have to spend time with ourselves to really take the power that Christine is referring to, because it's from that power that you are even able to express who you are, right? I think as a woman who grew up in Nigeria, to a lot of people, I mean, like Africa is a monolith to a lot of people. And Nigeria alone itself has over 400 languages. There are hundreds of languages that are spoken in Nigeria that I've never heard or I don't understand. And so for somebody to walk up to me and ask what my African name means is on a level of, and so, you know, one of the ways that I have taught myself is really working on myself. I can't control what is out there, but I can develop emotional resilience by spending more time to understanding what are the things that awakens certain emotions in me. What was that behavior? What impact did it have on me? And how am I going to be ready for the next time this happens?
Thank you so much. Wow, I'm just trying to also process as I navigate this time. Shall we, if it's okay with the panelists, I'd like to move on to the next question. So the question from the audience is, how can one be more mindful and aware that their narrative is being hijacked? Sometimes one is so naive and fearful, they don't even realize. And I think it does kind of link to our second question. How do we respect other people's boundaries while honoring our own? Would you agree? So I can restate the question if you want, but that's the question from the audience. And I've linked it to the one that we were going to say. Ray?
Yeah, so I've been thinking about this question of, you know, when does our narrative get hijacked, right? And what can we actually do? But, you know, sometimes when our narrative is getting hijacked, it's so quick. And like Sheyun said, like, you sort of need time to, I kind of like lost my train of thought, but so what can you do to hold your narrative? And I was just thinking about a story. So when my mother remarried my late stepfather, I was about 18 years old. And I had only met him like several times before the wedding, but he told me to call him James. Okay, fast forward. The first request that my mother made after the wedding was for me to call him Dad. So I did. But after like 10 years later, when he passed away, and I had reflected on how he had been the best father I've ever had, I thought, wouldn't it have been so much more meaningful for me and for him if I got to choose, or if I got to, yeah, if I got to choose when I called him Dad? It's a small offense, I think, maybe in like large picture of things. But you know, my mother took that power away from me. She hijacked my power, and it made her world complete for me to call her husband Dad, because that was something that my mother had felt sorry that she couldn't give me my entire life. But in my world, you know, he hadn't yet earned the right to be called Dad. So I'm still learning how to do this, but, you know, I think the simple answer is to learn how to say the word no. And that sometimes saying no actually allows you to honor yourself and your needs.
I love that, Ray. I really feel like that resonates with me. And I guess the one thing I want to maybe add to this is thinking about a community's story being hijacked. I feel like all of you have spoken really brilliantly to what it means to have your personal narrative hijacked and how people might be stealing it for their own purposes. And maybe just to add a little bit of a different perspective, I want to put forward this concept called playing Indian. And Philip DeLoria, you know, wrote an entire book about this behavior in which white Americans in the United States assume the identity of stereotypical Native people by wearing, you know, war bonnets and doing, you know, racist sort of mimicry of language. And we see that throughout the history of the United States, all the way back from the Boston Tea Party, when people were dressing up like Indians to kick that off, to today when you know, men and women wear like war bonnets at Coachella. So the idea of the Native people's story being hijacked, the real issue there is beyond not letting them speak for themselves, is you're erasing them entirely. And that is something that just cannot be accepted. So I think that this idea of determining boundaries is really important. If you see something like that, say something. And like thinking about how to respect other people's boundaries, ask them what they are. You know, a lot of times you maybe won't understand. There may be some sort of cultural miscommunication that could happen if you're not clear on asking people, is it okay if, you know, we share food together? That might not be okay for some people. They want their own plate of food. So I think that figuring out, you know, it's not something you need to be a psychic for. You can ask. And I certainly love it when people ask me. So I just wanted to add that perspective as well.
Thank you. Christine.
Yeah, I wanted to speak to the question in the chat. I love everything everyone's saying. I'm looking forward to the day we're all in the same room together. We're going to have this conversation again without the audience, and we'll, you know, we love you all. But the question, I keep reading it again, is how to be more mindful and aware that your narrative is being hijacked. And I think we come with an inborn alarm system that tells us when this is not my story anymore. Mine is situated approximately here. It causes immediate heart palpitations and sweat. And the feeling that this is not right. It happens when people, when they ask me where I'm from and I give them an answer and I say I'm American, and they say, no, really, what are you? Where do your ancestors come from? They've taken my right to decide where I'm from away from me. And I have a physical response to that. And those are emotions speaking. So I think if you have that happening, then honor that for yourself, because you have to protect yourself. This is a tough game. And it is okay to say, hold on a second. This does not feel like the me I'm putting in the world. I think you're seeing a different me than I want to be, or I'm not feeling very comfortable with the way I seem to be being in this right now. And I think we put way too much value on keeping a conversation going, when in reality, sometimes we need to just put the brakes on and say to the person we're speaking to, this is not comfortable now. Let me try to figure out why. And if you don't want to go that far, it's always a great idea to think, what are you really asking me? Is another, you know, what are you really asking me, or what are you really saying about me? Those are great questions to ask, just to put the other person on point, and buy yourself time to think about what's going on. Why does this not feel good? So those are strategies that you can use if you're feeling afraid of raising the question. Just, you know, it's always a good strategy to bounce the question back to someone else. Let them come up with their own answer. You don't have to figure out what they're doing. Let them try to figure it out. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. I have two very powerful questions from the audience that I'd like to jump in on. The first one is, what is an appropriate line or limit to draw for our emotional resilience? And I think the second one is a bit tied to it. So let me say that one as well. Do you have any mantras or sources of strength for when you are feeling like your personal or community story is not worthy of fighting for or protecting? Oh, actually, they're very different. Let's address the first one first. Excuse me. What is an appropriate line limit to draw for our emotional resilience? Does anyone have any thoughts on that?
Well, I think it's important for your emotional resilience. You need a community. I'm going back to that word community again. And part of that is having people in your life. You know, I think everybody needs like their own board of directors. And you have to really make sure you are surrounding yourself with people that in some ways support you, not only culturally, but, you know, emotionally, in your identity, affirm who you are, right? And that doesn't necessarily mean people that look like you, sound like you. People like that come in different shapes and form, and you have to be open to that. You know, there are people who, in a lot of ways, when I first came to the US, you know, I'd never interacted with somebody from Nigeria, but had this openness about them. They had this open-mindedness that in some ways they were more supportive of me than folks who looked like me or sounded like me, right? And so it's really identifying who those people are and, you know, making sure that you spend time with those people also. Another way to build emotional resilience is really by, somebody said this earlier, but as hard as it is, resilience is really like when you are building muscle. When you first start, it's gonna be painful. You hurt everywhere is sore, but the more you do it, the stronger you get. And so you have to be willing to put yourself out there. I think at times with certain populations, marginalized populations, there's a tendency for us to withdraw, but it keeps our voices from being heard, and it keeps us from sharing our stories, and it doesn't help the dynamic. And so that's part of how you build resilience, is to keep trying, but making sure you have rest days, and those rest days are your board of directors that keeps nudging you, you got this, you can do it.
And would you all agree that in terms of an appropriate kind of line or limit to draw might be perhaps in terms of the boundaries and such, or emotional resilience, as Christine, you referred to, and also Sheyun, like what awakens in you that is discomfort, right? I think we all innately have our own thresholds, for boundaries, for emotional resilience, for survivance, and comfort levels. So I think it goes back to that knowing yourself and being reflective to know kind of where the limit is for you to stay healthy.
Can I give an example? So I've worked at Duke I was in Stern Affairs for about 12 and a half years, and now I'm in at the provost office for, you know, a year plus. So going to 14 years, and I got two emails today where my first names were mispronounced, right? A few years back, that would have, gosh, like, oh my goodness, they can't get it. But I'm at a place now where, honestly, it doesn't bother me anymore. I have claimed that power. Now, when the context is right, I tell people, the first letter of my name looks like an S, but it's not, because there are tons of alphabets all over the world, and it's actually a sh. It's not an S. But then there are a lot of times when the context is, I don't have the opportunity to maybe give somebody some kind of supportive education. And so I let it go, right? And have something that is called positive regard. You know, thinking the best of that other party, that they are not trying to be intentionally. There are times when people are being malicious intentionally, and I know that. But there are times when they are not. And just keeping my peace and my well-being also is important.
Okay, Christine, you wanna jump in real quick before we move to another question?
I feel like I'm gonna tell a story that's gonna explain to you exactly why Seun and I are opposites. Which, first thing I would say, there is no such thing as an appropriate line for emotional resilience. When it comes to emotional resilience, there is your line and no other line matters. Your line is the only line that matters for you. So if you've had it, you've had it. That's fine. You do not need to explain yourself. You do not need to feel bad about it. That would be the worst thing. Just, that's it. I'm done. I'm out. And where Seun has learned to forgive people. I live in the Netherlands, where people tend to say exactly what they think all the time. And part of what's made me stronger is actually learning to basically deal it right back. And so, you know, as an American abroad, you can imagine I've had a number of people over the last few months ask me about politics. And I've chosen in many instances to say nothing. So, you know, people will say to me, what do you think about a certain president? And I say, well, you know, he's in office right now, or what are you going to do? And I say, well, I voted and I have nothing else to say. And I had somebody ask me the other day, it was someone at school who's never spoken to me before, a fellow parent at school. We've never had a conversation before. And he, like, you know, we're waiting for kids. And he goes, so you can vote, right? In the States? Yes, I can vote. Did you vote? Yes, I did vote. And who did you vote for? I'm not telling you. Same smile, same delivery. That's not territory I'm going to talk to you about. You know, that's it. And then just for me, I then sit back and watch the stammer happen and just enjoy their discomfort a little, because they were doing that to me and now it's their turn. So perhaps less graceful, but for me, that's taking something back. They can't put me in that position. I get to choose. So.
UNC Duke rivalry, what can I say? So I'm gonna jump, can we continue with the next question, which says, do you have any mantras or sources of strength for when you're feeling like your personal or community story is not worthy of fighting for or protecting?
Can I just say something? I had a really sharp reaction to that question, but then I found myself minimizing my thought. So I'm just gonna tell you the sharp reaction that I had. And my reaction is, there's never a moment where your story is not worth fighting for. And then I'll tell you what I minimized it to is, actually, I can't remember. I think the sharp reaction took over.
Thank you for sharing that. Thank you for your authenticity. It's very important.
Ray, I share your reaction of course, you know, your story is worth fighting for, but I think, I don't know that I have a specific mantra, but something I bear in mind is what would have happened had my grandfather's story, had he not felt they were worth fighting for, I would have lost out on a lot of, you know, a lot of history, a lot of, you know, a lot of culture. So I think about it in sort of a generational spectrum. So I am so blessed and lucky that he felt his stories were worth fighting for and shared them with me and my mother and my, you know, all of my cousins and brothers. And, you know, so I have benefited from someone deciding, no, this is worth fighting for. And so when I think kind of forward, I want my son or, you know, my hypothetical grandchildren to feel like, oh man, I'm so glad that she felt like that story was worth telling. Even if at the time I maybe minimized it or, you know, made it silly so it was memorable. Like we figured out a way to share that with future generations. So I think this idea of temporality might be helpful and context in a family or a community.
Yeah, I really love what Dia said. And I think that's really where you find the strength. When you don't have your personal strength, you go to the strength that you've been told. You know, I remember some things that, you know, my parents have said to me, the way they say, you know, for example, my name, the letters that my dad, I'm from a family where, you know, people were big letter writers. And I think because folks were traveling all throughout my childhood, we wrote a lot of letters. So it's going back, I think, to that source of who you are or where you are. And I think it's important to be connected to your community. It's so, so important. I know that one of the things that people fight is denigration. When people start in some ways rejecting who they are or their story and claiming other people's story so that they can belong or be accepted, that actually is a challenge. And so, you know, just reiterating what Dear said, I think it's important to have somebody who a line that we go to of where we are from and who we are and what we have to offer is important.
Some other folks had unmuted, yeah.
The thing, I very much share the being inspired by my children to make sure that they know where they come from. And that comes from also my personal experience of a lack of knowledge of where I come from, because there were a lot of stories that didn't get told to me. My mother was from Taiwan, and I've essentially had to learn Taiwanese history reading, and then had to deal with being told I was reading the wrong books because they weren't Taiwanese. But I found myself finding, you know, one of the best connections I made with my mother's history was through a novel that I found and then reaching out to the author. And, you know, don't discount that other people's stories that are parallel, if they're not even the same, but if they're parallel, if they're in the same space, those can give you so much strength because they were worth telling. They were worth telling and putting on film or putting into paintings or installations or books, and yours is too.
Thank you. Yeah, Ray. Oh gosh, I'm sorry, it's getting late. Ray.
I was going to say something which kind of slipped my mind already. It'll come up again later.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did I make I was just gonna say, I'm so glad for those all these examples, because I think it speaks to modeling as well, right? Not just for future generations, but just for society, for people around us, modeling this ability to fight for and be resilient with your narrative, or carry it forward with purpose and long-term, I would say, mission. So great. Oh my goodness. It is 3:12, everybody. So we're gonna transition to the third theme, which I mean, it really is most of more of a summary, but the question that I have here is, how are you, or how can we be reclaiming our narrative or narratives? I think, you know, many of you have shared a lot of strategies, but if you could maybe speak to the sustainability perhaps of reclaiming our narratives, regardless of where we are in that journey, in that reclaiming, I should say. People have any thoughts for that?
Yes, Christine, why don't you go ahead? Go ahead. So I'm just gonna go around the room and share, you know, build on what everybody has said that I really loved. Say no, you know, Ray told you, I think it's important to set those boundaries and know, you know, when enough is enough. And being able to say no, though, there are different ways of saying no, right? I think you can say no angrily even, but still be, you know, not composed, that's not the word, but still in a very healthy way, right? I think there's destructive anger and there's constructive anger. And so I think you have to want to guard your story, and it needs to be so important to you that you know when somebody's getting it right and when they are getting it wrong, and being willing to affirm and to say no, you know, when it's important. What Christine said about knowing the, you know, the limit of your emotional resilience, you know, I think is really, really important. The point that I was making was you have to build your own emotional resilience, because you can't control what other people would do to you. People are always going to do different things, either intentionally, unintentionally, microaggressively, discriminatively. You know, it's all going to be there, but you have control over what you do. And so you have to find ways to build emotional resilience within you. And part of the way you do that is, you know, getting to know yourself more and also making sure you have a support system. And, you know, I love what they said about the importance of knowing where we come from and gaining strength from that. Nobody should be ashamed of who they are or where they come from or what they have to offer. Mm. We all have something to offer to the community. And it's really, really important that we are willing to make ourselves available, right? To share that, and that we know the sources. And there are so many ways right now that you can learn more about, you know, other cultures or about your own culture, and getting to know and asking questions and sharing with people. And the last thing I want to talk about is the importance of, there's something called continuous learning. Mm-hmm. And we all need that. So the idea is not for people to tell our stories perfectly and to be able to, you know, retell our stories to us. But we also have to be in a place where we understand, I think Christine said at the beginning, we understand that we are also changing and constantly evolving and being open to growth. We don't come to a place, that's why I struggle with the word cultural competency. I don't believe there's something like that. I think we have to be in a place where we are constantly growing and developing and changing and opening ourselves to uncomfortable situations. And being willing to have conversations with people who think differently from us, who have different backgrounds, right? This is where the narratives really, it becomes part of, you know, this kilt. I like to think of it. And in a lot of ways, the threading of it, it's again, being part of something that you can use and cover yourself, but it stands out because it's distinct. So those are my final thoughts.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm so glad you brought that up because it segues perfectly to a point I wanted to make as well. We have been talking about reclaiming our narratives, and I think the mode of that we've been talking about it is through speaking, right? And the power of oral histories and retelling and storytelling and the longevity of it, a kind of, you know, it's almost eternal, right? But I do also wanna just take a moment to highlight the importance of listening and listening as an active skill, not a passive, not a passive sense, but to work on that as well. I think in sharing our narratives, we also need to have the strength to patiently listen to other people's narratives, whether they are dominant or non-dominant in the societal structure that we are living in. And so I just wanted to put a word in for that to speaking nearby also includes listening nearby. So, excellent. Oh my goodness. I cannot believe that the time has just flown. I feel like I could talk to all of you for much longer. So, I mean, I would love to just take a minute and for each person perhaps to share a word, a phrase, a thought that really resonated with you today in our discussion, and any last words you might have for our audience. And I do want to remind the audience that this session is recorded and a link will be available. But so you can all just take a minute to think about that. I'm also happy to go first as you collect your thoughts. Christine, would you like to share?
I think if there's a word I'm gonna take out of this that's is survivance. It gives me a tremendous amount to think about and I find it empowering. And if there's a thing I want to give, it's so wonderful that you just said listening to stories, because I wrote down story listening. It's got a circle around it on my notebook right now. Your story isn't done, not only in the sense that you're still moving through it, but in the sense that you get to practice it over and over again, and you can change it anytime you want. And a story is always also a conversation. It's always you and an audience. And your audience is giving you something back whenever you tell your story. Pay attention to what they're giving you back, because they are the way that you understand whether your story is saying the thing that you want it to say or something else. So that two-way street is important, not only as a listener, but as a storyteller, to remember you're always getting something back from your story. and that you can go back and take that to work on it, to figure out if your narrative isn't doing what you want it to do, you have the information you need to start changing it if you need to. And that's, it's in your hands. It's up to you. Thank you so much, ladies. This has been a brilliant evening for me.
Yes, this theme of claiming, right, of having authority, taking back power that was hijacked perhaps or stolen, I think has been, something that's come up a lot in our discussion, which is wonderful. Anybody else wanna summarize or share some final thoughts?
It's been so wonderful. I wish I could pronounce some of the words that in foreign languages that have been shared. So I'm not going to butcher those words, but I do have them in mind. I think a theme that has stuck out to me throughout, that's threaded through many of our replies, is this idea of resilience. And like really, it's brave to own your story and to be strong and hold on to it and share it. I think this idea of resilience in maybe figuring out a way to share a story that at first, like, you know, I think, oh, people will find it boring or people don't want to hear about me. It takes like resilience and strength to put those thoughts aside, put that negative self-talk away and really make space for you to share and for other people to feel comfortable sharing with you. So I think those are the concepts I'm really walking away with.
Thank you.
I wanted to say that some of the things that I thought of while we were all talking to each other, I've written down everything that you all said and I'll be thinking about it for a really long time. The things that I wanted to mention were, so Christine talked about how when people ask her where is she from, right, and how like that she has like a physical reaction to that question. And there was a TED talk that I watched by she's a photographer and a writer and a speaker, and her name is Taye Selassie. And her TED Talk is about this question: instead of asking, where are you from? Instead ask, where are you a local? And I just wanted to kind of let that be a question that we normalize.
That is very powerful. Where are you a local? Lovely. Seun, any final thoughts?
I thought I shared my
okay
already, but I want to acknowledge everyone for the stories. Ray, I felt like what you did was really beautiful in weaving kind of your own personal story throughout this. I feel like I know you so much more. And I thought that was really, really beautiful. And I just want to thank Dare. It's wonderful to share this space with you. And Christine and Sukyun, I already knew you guys, but it's wonderful to share this space and to learn from all of you. Thank you for sharing your stories with us.
Thank you. Thank you all so much. I think the word that really resonated with me today is the word awaken. I feel like I need to think about those parts of me that have gone dormant, that might need a little awakening, but also how do I awaken others to be open and collaborative and equally, you know, placed, for lack of a better word, to not only speak, but listen to each other's stories. So I am going to wrap us up for today. Thank you. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you for your very insightful questions and your shared intrigue in this very important work. We are passionate about these issues, and we all, I think, would be happy to continue to discuss any of these further. And just, you know, another reminder that it will be recorded. And I just do want to mention again, many thanks to Stacy Salazar, Vice Provost of Graduate Studies, for her support and encouragement, to Erin Jakowski, Associate Dean in Graduate Studies, for all of her work behind the scenes and collaboration, and also Director of Events, John Lipitz, for his wonderful technical savvy and support. And just in closing, I would like to leave you all with a quote that I hope you find inspiring. This is a quote from the beginning of the book that I mentioned, Dictée, by Teresa Hakyong-cha. And the quote reads, "May I speak words more naked than flesh, stronger than bone, more resilient than sinew, sensitive than nerve." And is from the poet Sappho. So we say goodbye and we hope to continue these conversations. You know, Speaking Nearby is a series. And so perhaps depending, you know, we don't know where this is gonna go, but I think we all are open to it. And this is powerful work that we're doing lifelong. So I just wanna thank everybody. Thank you, all panelists, you amazing human beings. Thank you so much for sharing all of your insight, knowledge, authenticity. It's been truly amazing. It's been an amazing experience. Okay, so I think that's, goodbye everybody, audience. Please feel free to reach out to any of us. Thank you.